Ending, but we will keep it for some time later because last week also I missed a lecture because of technical issues. So I want to continue ahead with heat and thermodynamics and application of first law of thermodynamics today. And I will come back to the discussion of the doubts of major test 7, probably in the second half of today's lecture or otherwise in the next lecture. In the meantime, if there are any questions you were not able to do in the advanced paper in particular, you can also send me by WhatsApp. I will send you some hints or some methods, etc., of solving. Okay. So this is heat and thermodynamics session number 6 for us. So let us begin. Now we come to the main problem solving part of heat and thermodynamics, where we'll be using some of the elements that we use that we've derived in kinetic theory of gases earlier, along with the principle of the first law of thermodynamics, and you are familiar with it completely from chemistry also. So therefore it will be easy to follow this and quite easy to concentrate on the problems. Yeah, very good. So I will keep the discussion of the MT7, the major test 7, I'll keep it for the next week. Then students who have not given the mains paper can finish it by then. So let's concentrate fully ahead on first law of thermodynamics and in general heat and thermodynamics today. Okay. So just a quick recap of the elements of kinetic theory of gases that we've seen. By using the elements of the or the assumptions of the kinetic model, we saw that V RMS is square root of 3PV divided by total mass. Okay. Or that becomes square root of 3RT by molar mass or 3KT by small m. And we of course have the relation PV equal to NRT or PV is equal to number of molecules into Boltzmann constant into T, where of course we understand number of moles is number of molecules divided by Avogadro's number, and Boltzmann constant is universal gas constant divided by Avogadro's number. So these are the standard things. Now further up from this, we see that average translational kinetic energy per molecule that becomes half mv RMS square, so that is 3/2 kT, and therefore the average kinetic energy per molecule per degree of freedom becomes 1/2 kT. So this is a very important equation. This is the equipartition of energy concept over here, and therefore from this we get that the average kinetic energy per molecule becomes F into half KT, where F is degrees of freedom. So F is equal to 3 for monoatomic gases, 3 translational degrees of freedom, and that's about it. Whereas for diatomic gases, F is 5. That is 3 translational plus 2 rotational degrees of freedom. And for polyatomic gases, it can be 5, 6, 7, etc., depending on the structure. So this is the general concept about degrees of freedom with respect to kinetic energy. So from this, we learned that the internal energy, now this is the new thing here, the internal energy of an ideal gas sample of n moles at pressure, volume and temperature like this, okay, and degrees of freedom F. Okay, so how do we define the internal energy of an ideal gas. So going back to one of the assumptions of the kinetic model, we saw that there is no intermolecular force between gas molecules. So the only type of I use three translational plus two rotational. There are degrees of freedom I use. So translation can happen along three mutually perpendicular axes x, y, and z, but rotation can happen only about two possible axes, both of which are bisecting the axis of the molecule perpendicularly. Whereas the rotation about the molecule's own symmetry axis does not involve any kinetic energy because the moment of inertia about such an axis is zero. Okay, so that is why there are only two rotational degrees of freedom. So remember, we had discussed that a diatomic molecule is linear in shape. It's like a dumbbell shape. So the moment of inertia about its own symmetry axis, it does not count. It's zero. But the moment of inertia about an axis bisecting the dumbbell perpendicularly, that is a non-zero quantity. Hence, there are two degrees of freedom for the rotational kinetic energy, whereas there are three degrees of freedom for the translational kinetic energy. Okay, that's how the concept of F equal to 5 came for the degrees of freedom for diatomic gas. Okay, now coming back to the concept of internal energy. So from the assumptions of kinetic model, what we had understood is that the gas can store only one type of energy, the gas molecules, that is kinetic energy. So the internal energy is nothing but the total kinetic energy of the gas molecules. So we'll generally denote the internal energy with the symbol U. But unlike in mechanics, here U is not potential energy because there is no force between the intermolecular, there's no intermolecular force between the molecules of an ideal gas. So there's no question of potential energy because where there's no conservative force, we cannot define potential energy. So that means the sample of an ideal gas, its molecules cannot store any form of potential energy. Its molecules can only store kinetic energy. And that becomes the what we call the internal energy of the gas. So the internal energy U is nothing but it is equal to the total kinetic energy of its molecules. That gas samples molecules, the total amount of kinetic energy stored by all of them put together, that is what we define as the internal energy. So that should become the number of molecules into the average kinetic energy per molecule. So that should become n into degrees of freedom into half kT. But keep in mind that n into k is the same thing as number of moles into gas constant. So this is nf by 2 rT. So this becomes the formula for the internal energy of an ideal gas, which, as you know, we'll be using a lot in the first law of thermodynamics applications. So we can also write this as a product of pressure and volume. So internal energy can also be written as F by 2 into pressure into volume, or NF by 2 RT. So these two formulae are interchangeable. Wherever we have an NRT kind of term, we can always interchange it with product of pressure and volume in thermodynamics. So the reason why the internal energy of the ideal gas consists of only the kinetic energy of its molecules is because, remember, gas molecules do not experience intermolecular attraction force. Before we proceed into first law and its applications, one last thing as part of kinetic theory of gases we'll see is something called the if there is vibrational kinetic energy involved, but even then that vibration is happening within a molecule, so there is no intermolecular attractive force. That is like an interatomic potential energy. You understanding the point, Aman? If a gas molecule is vibrating, it is vibrating with respect to its own center of mass. It's like the atoms of the molecules, they are vibrating with respect to their center of mass. So the kind of force, the restorative force involved for that vibration is the interatomic force, not the intermolecular force. So this statement is still valid that there is no intermolecular attraction force, but yes, that vibrational kinetic energy will also include some kind of elastic potential energy, you can say, of that molecule or whatever. But primarily here we are talking about monoatomic and diatomic gases, so there is no kind of potential energy involved at all. It is pure kinetic energy, which is covered in the degrees of freedom. Okay, so this becomes the formula for the internal energy of an ideal gas, which is at the state, pressure, volume and temperature equal to PV and T, and number of moles equal to that much. Okay, yeah, so now as I was saying before we move on, we'll quickly discuss one additional concept, and that is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curve. That is the relationship between velocity, distribution and energy. Okay, so that is basically quite a complex function, but we will understand it in context of something very simple. Okay, so this Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curve is the graphical representation of the distribution of the different velocities of gas molecules. So it is a curve that is of probability of distribution. It is probability of a certain velocity with respect to the velocity of gas molecules. It is magnitude of velocity, of course. Okay. So typically the velocities are in the range of 100 meters per second, depending on temperatures. But even at a certain temperature for a gas sample, the different molecules will have velocities which are in this kind of range. Something like this in meters per second. So the distribution curve of velocities that looks something like this at a certain temperature, at T equal to T1. At a different temperature, that distribution curve will change, and we'll discuss how it will change. So by probability, we mean what we are plotting is more like a probability density function. So that probability density is basically defined like this. It is 1 upon capital N dN by dV. So let's understand what this probability density term means. N is the total number of molecules. Okay. And dN is the number of molecules having a velocity between V and V plus dV. Okay. So that is this term. That's the probability density. So basically, at a certain velocity, if we draw a vertical line like this. So let's look at the interpretation of this graph. So the interpretation of this graph is like this, that at a certain velocity, v, let's say, if we look at the y coordinate of this graph, it gives me this quantity. Okay, so let's say this is some arbitrary v, and this is the value of 1 by n dn by tv at that point. Okay, so now if I take a small range of velocity like this, I draw this vertical strip and calculate the area of that strip. So the second point over here is at v plus dv, whereas the first point where I've drawn this vertical strip, now the first point or the first line of the vertical strip is at a velocity v, and the second one is at a velocity v plus dv. So the area of this strip of a vertical strip, okay, that will become 1 by n dn by dv. Okay, that is the height of the strip multiplied by the width of the strip, which is dv. So it is nothing but dn by n. So it is basically the probability of a molecule, I mean the probability that molecules have velocity between v and v plus dv, because dn is the number of molecules which is having a velocity in this range. So that number of molecules having that specific range of velocity divided by the total number of molecules is the probability factor for the velocity to range between v and v plus dv. So because it's this quantity, it is nothing but the probability for the velocity to range between, so that particular vertical strip, its area is equal to the probability for the velocity to range between v and v plus dv. So that's why the total area subtended by the curve on the x-axis, that is nothing but the total number of molecules. Sorry, that will be equal to unity, because the probability of all velocities to exist between 0 and whatever the maximum velocity, that will be this 1, that area will be 1. But a strip's area that is a probability factor. Okay, so now if we see the comparison of this graph at two different temperatures, let's say now we consider a different temperature T2, which is greater than T1. I mean, obviously the graph starts from zero. Become like this. T2 is greater than T1. Okay. So at any given temperature, the particular velocity which has the maximum probability, that is called the most probable velocity. The maximum probability we denote it with BMP. So additionally, at any particular temperature, from its Maxwell distribution curve, the value of velocity at the peak or maximum probability point. Is called the most probable velocity. So it has this kind of a symbol. Okay. And it is given by a particular formula which we will see next. So most probable velocity is given by a formula, square root of 8RT divided by pi m, where pi is the irrational number, approximately equal to 3.142. Oh, sorry, my mistake. Most probable is not this formula. Most probable is square root of 2RT pi m. This is another formula called the mean speed. We'll come to that later. The most probable velocity formula is square root of 2RT by m. So it's a little confusing, these formulae, but just make sure you remember them. So RMS velocity is what we use for equipartition of energy and all that, and that one is square root of 3RT by m, whereas most probable velocity comes from a statistical formula whose derivation we will not get into over here. That's not in our syllabus. Okay. But the value is important for us, and that is equal to square root of 2RT by m. Yes, Vaishnavi, that was the point you were making, that it's 2RT by m. Okay. So actually, this is a theoretical part that you don't need to know in too much detail for JEE, because you will not be asked any numerical problems really based out of this, but only the formula for the most probable speed and also something else called the mean speed. These two formulae you have to remember. So that's why I'm putting these formulae in these box brackets, so that they're there for reference. But again, generally, these are not so important. The more important thing is that the RMS velocity, which we get from kinetic theory of gases, that value and how to use it in equipartition of energy, and from that, the formula for the total internal energy of an ideal gas that we saw earlier today. Those are the more important formulae. Okay. Now, based on this graph, there is one more important quantity, which is the mean speed. Mean or average speed. That one is given by the formula which I had written earlier, square root of 8RT divided by pi, where m is again the molar mass, and T is, remember, always in Kelvin or absolute temperature of a given gas. So in all these formulae, T is always in Kelvin. M is molar mass in kgs, Kelvins. And R should be substituted in the SI unit of 8.314. joules per mole in Kelvin to get the values of these in meters per second. So this average speed actually comes from doing this calculation. Where dN is the number of molecules having a particular speed V. Okay, now the distribution function itself is given by a rather complex transcendental type of relation or exponential transcendental type of relation. So that function is, you can note it down, but you don't need to memorize it. Okay. So it is like this. The probability distribution you can always replace PV equal to nRT, so RT can be replaced by PV divided by small n. That's correct. So basically this quantity RT by m can always be replaced by PV by n capital M or PV by capital M into small m. These are always interchangeable. Okay. Anyway, so the probability distribution function, that is 1 upon n dn by dv, is determined from statistical mechanics to be this kind of a formula. Put this in a bracket with the power half on top. Okay. Into this exponential term of minus kinetic energy per molecule divided by kT. So this thing is the power, that minus of half mv squared by kT is the power of the exponential term. Hence the graph of it is like this. The graph of this function versus v, it's this sort of a graph. So one thing you can see is that it starts from the origin. That means the probability for gas molecules to have zero velocity is zero. And that's another reason why, at least according to any theoretical model we have, and also according to laboratory physics, zero Kelvin is not practically achievable. Because zero Kelvin is theoretically that temperature at which the probability for gas molecules to have zero velocity should become 100% or one. Whereas cannot be that. So yes. That is the case. Yeah, sorry, I just got disconnected for a moment. Yeah, so coming back to this function. Yeah, Kevin, I will scroll up. Yeah, so I will come back to the probability distribution function. First, you just understand the meaning of the probability distribution curve itself. And this interpretation, which I have written down in the note over here, that the area of this vertical strip whose thickness is dV, and this vertical strip over here, its thickness is dV. So it's the strip that is ranging from a velocity of v to v plus dV. So that the area of this strip is equal to this probability fraction, dN by m. So it is the probability factor for molecules to have a velocity ranging between v and v plus dV. Okay, so now coming to the second part, this is actually dN by n. This term is like this. The term for 1 by n dN by dV, which is the probability distribution function, is slightly different, and that is given by this formula 4 pi v square into m upon 2 pi kt to the power 3 by 2 into that exponential factor e raised to power minus half mv square by kt. This factor. So you'll find this in HC1 or any other standard book. It's there in your module also. I'll take you through that once. But this is the probability distribution function. In this, M is capital M by Avogadro's number. It's molecular mass. So as I said, this formula is not compulsory for you to remember. It's just the concept that is more important. So basically, when a gas is temperature is changing from, let's say, higher to lower, the distribution curve for it, Maxwell distribution curve, Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curve, at higher temperature is something like this. This is the most probable speed. So this is a higher temperature. At a comparatively lower temperature, the graph would have changed like this. The most probable speed decreases with temperature, but its probability increases because the curve becomes thinner and thinner. That is the nature of this exponential transcendental graph. And at an even lower temperature, the graph would shift to something like this. So this is T1, the middle one is T2, and the red one is T3. Then they are in increasing order of temperature. T1 is less than T2 is less than T3. Okay, so this is not very important, but these two formulae are the important ones you should remember. The mean speed formula and the most probable speed formula, along with, of course, what you learned earlier about the RMS speed. Remember, V RMS is square root of 3 RT by M. So RMS is the maximum one out of the three, and means most probable is the minimum one out of the three. It's also easy to understand. Okay, so that completes our kinetic theory of gases. Now we move on to the most important part of heat and thermodynamics for us from the JEE point of view, both in terms of the conceptual level of questions as well as in terms of the total weightage number of questions that come. And that is the first law of thermodynamics and its applications. So any process in which the state of a gas is being changed because of the exchange of heat and the exchange of mechanical energy with it, or mechanical work done on the gas or by the gas, whatever, by exchanging mechanical work and by exchanging heat, some kind of combination of these two things, if we are changing the state of a gas is represented by its pressure, volume and temperature. So if such a process is changing the state of the gas, then in general, it is called a thermodynamic process. So one where the state of a gas or a system is changed by the exchange of heat. Okay. And or mechanical work. Okay. That kind of a process is called a thermodynamic process, and for any thermodynamic process, the heat supplied, the net heat supplied to the gas is equal to the change in its internal energy plus the work done by the gas. So this is the statement of first law. Now, at first inspection, you will find it different from the chemistry equivalent of it. But there, W was work done on the gas. Here, W is work done by the gas. So make sure you understand this over here. Q is the net heat supplied to the gas in the process. So the gas is absorbing a net amount of heat, then Q will become positive. Whereas if the gas is losing heat, then Q will become negative. So if the gas absorbs a net amount of heat during a process, then Q will be positive because it is net heat supplied to the gas. Okay, so to the gas by its surrounding environment. Whereas if it loses or dissipates a net amount of heat, then Q will become negative. Because if the gas is losing heat, then the net heat supplied to the gas is a negative quantity. Then the next thing, delta U is, of course, the change in its internal energy. And from kinetic theory of gases, we have seen that internal energy is total kinetic energy of molecules. That is okay, so we'll come back to this formula later. And W is, now this is very important, and this is where it is different from chemistry. It's just the opposite. It is work done by the gas on its surrounding. So it is work done by the gas. So W is integration of PdV. So W is positive for expansion because dV will be positive during an expansion, and W will be negative for a compression. That is, when a gas is being compressed, its volume is decreasing. So change in volume is negative. That means the external agent is doing work on the gas. So the work done by the gas will become a negative quantity. So that is the sign convention over here. So make sure you understand the sign convention very carefully. So particularly the work done term, it is opposite to what work done is taken in chemistry. There it is taken as work done on the gas. So we have Q plus W is equal to delta U. But that is exactly opposite of the term work done over here, because here it is work done by the gas and not on the gas. So make sure you are clear about this term, and let me know if anybody has a doubt about it. Because this is very important to make sure that you have this understood from the beginning. No, so Sniketa, see, that is the thing over here. The sign convention for work done is that it is such that when the gas is expanding, it is doing positive work because it is work done by the gas. I'll explain it in a diagram in a moment, then it will be more clear. So that is why it is PdV integration and not minus PdV, because it is work done by the gas on its environment and not the work done on the gas by the external agent. Is this point clear, Sniketa and Vaishnavi? It is work done by the gas and not work done on the gas. So let's just think of a sort of practical situation where we are applying this concept. So if we visualize a situation where what is happening is we have some kind of a chamber. Which is a double-walled insulated chamber. But it is also filled with a piston. I mean, it's also fitted with a piston. That's a free piston. We have some kind of an ideal gas inside. And also the piston is loaded with some mass. Now suppose we supply heat to the gas, okay, and these walls are insulating so that heat cannot escape. So what will happen is that the heat will tend to, heat is ultimately nothing but a form of kinetic energy. It is molecular activity, molecular kinetic energy. So supplying that heat energy will mean that these molecules will start moving faster. So as they move faster, that increases the pressure that the molecules apply on the walls of the container, including the pressure they apply on the piston. So now what will happen is that the gas might apply a force on the piston. So that force will be equal to the pressure multiplied by area, where A is the area of the piston. Okay. And P is the pressure of the gas. So F is the force applied by the gas on the piston. So if the piston is in equilibrium, then this force should balance the weight plus the force that the atmospheric pressure is applying. But if we increase the pressure of the gas, it will tend to go out of equilibrium and the piston might displace by a small amount dx like this. So as it displaces, the work done by the gas, by F, that means it is by the gas, that work done will be F dx. So it will be P into A into dx. Now A into dx is nothing but the change in volume of the gas. So it is P dV, because if this total thing is x, then the volume of the gas inside, so if it is at pressure P, volume A into x, so the change in volume is A into dx. Okay, so A dx is nothing but dV, the change in volume. So applying that over here, you can see that work done by the gas is integration of this. So it is integration of PDV. So you can see, as long as the piston is going up, the gas is expanding. So the work done by the gas is positive. But when the piston, if it starts coming down because we are removing heat or something, then the work done by the gas will become negative, because dV will be negative. Or the displacement of the piston will be in the direction opposite to the force that the gas is applying on it. Hence that sign convention, that work done by the gas is positive for an expansion and negative for a compression. So W is positive when the gas expands. So dV is positive, whereas the work done by the gas becomes negative when the gas compresses or is compressed by an external agent. So dV is negative. So then the external agent is doing work on the gas and the work done by the gas is negative. Very good. Okay. So now you can see, whatever heat you are supplying, part of it might go into increasing the kinetic energy of the gas molecules. So that is nothing but the increase in internal energy. But the remaining part has to go into mechanical work done on the piston. Energy cannot be destroyed. So whatever heat energy we provided, it can go into two pools, okay, or into two categories. One is that energy can go into increasing the kinetic energy of the gas molecules. So it can contribute to a change in the internal energy of the gas. Or two, it can contribute to the work that the gas is doing on the piston as a result of the extra energy supplied, that one increasing the pressure and all that. But there is no third form of energy in which it can get converted, the heat energy that is being supplied. It's converted either to the internal energy of the gas or into mechanical work done on the piston. So the total heat supplied, the net heat supplied to the gas, must be equal to the sum of these two quantities, the change in internal energy plus the work done by the gas. Hence, it's a logical statement of conservation of energy that Q is equal to delta U plus W for first law of thermodynamics. This dW is the work done by whom? By the force F. And who is applying the force? It is the gas. So ultimately, it is the work done by the gas. Understood? No? It's work done by that particular force. Because on the piston, there are other things also which are doing work. There's the normal force that the weight above it is applying downwards. That's also doing work. There's the force due to atmospheric pressure from above, which is acting downwards. And atmospheric P naught, pressure P naught into area. That's also doing work. But we are considering only the work done by this particular force F, which is nothing but the force that the gas is applying. So the gas inside the container, that system is doing how much work on the piston? It is doing this much work, FdX. So hence, when we consider the term work done by the gas in our statement of first law, it becomes equal to integration of PdP. Okay. Now the next thing we should understand that for any thermodynamic process that is conducted very slowly, or technically what we call quasi-statically. Quasi-static means almost static. Quasi means, you know, approximate or almost. So almost static or approximately static, that kind of a process. So what is happening in such a quasi-static thermodynamic process or a slow process is whatever change we are introducing to the state of the gas by supplying heat or doing work on the gas or combination of the two things, or by absorbing heat from the gas, letting the gas do work, whatever be the case, if we allow these changes to happen very slowly, then it is called a quasi-static process. So what that means is that as we are changing the state of the gas is always in almost equilibrium. So that's what is meant by quasi-static, that we supply a bit of heat, so the pressure increases, but it increases by a very small amount. So the piston is still almost in equilibrium. It just moves up a little bit and comes to a new state of equilibrium. Then we again supply a little bit more heat, but very slowly. So the piston immediately comes to a new state of equilibrium. So we are not ever doing this kind of situation where we supply heat suddenly by a large amount so that the piston goes to equilibrium. It starts accelerating. We don't want that to happen. We are talking about quasi-static processes. So if we are supplying heat or we are absorbing heat, or if you're pushing the piston down and doing work on the gas, any such change done by the external agent must be done very, very slowly, so that during that change, at every point of time in between, the gas is in a quasi-static state. That means almost equilibrium kind of state. So if it is in a quasi-static state, then we can define the pressure, temperature, and volume of the gas. If it is not, then many of the properties of the gas, like the pressure, the density, the temperature, etc., will not be isotropic through the gas. And then we cannot apply the ideal gas equation that PV is equal to nRT. So for the ideal gas equation to be valid, for the formula for internal energy to be valid, the gas molecules must be almost approximately in a state of equilibrium at every point in between. Hence, it is important that next when we apply a particular formula to first law, that Q is equal to delta U plus W. Now, this is a universal statement. There's no problem with this. But when we apply a particular formula for delta U, when we apply the formula W is equal to integration PdV for work done, then it must be that the gas is going through a process which is quasi-static. Otherwise, we cannot apply this formula because the pressure is not consistent through the gas like that. So a quasi-static process is one which is very slow, such that during the process, every state of the gas, every intermediate state is almost an equilibrium state, or it is a quasi-static state. So for such a state, we can define the process on the PV space as a graph or as a curve. So for any quasi-static, that is extremely slow thermodynamic process. Okay, from some initial state, say P initial, V initial, T initial, to some final state. Let's say P final, V final, T final. So from this state to this state, okay, obviously for N moles of an ideal gas, okay, with degrees of freedom F known. Okay. So for this kind of thing, as long as we are talking about any quasi-static process or very slow process, okay, the thermodynamics or the thermodynamic process can be represented by a curve on the PV space, okay, from initial to final state. So as long as it's a quasi-static process, we can define the process or we can describe the process on the basis of a PV curve or a particular path, taking it from our initial state to final state in the PV space. Because any point in the PV space, remember, it not only represents a particular pressure and a particular volume, but it also represents a particular temperature, because we're talking about an ideal gas. So pressure, volume, and temperature are linked like this. Now we are going from this state to this state. Final pressure, final volume, and therefore some final temperature. Yeah, I'll just answer your question in just a moment. Okay. So if we are going from this initial state to this final state through a quasi-static process, that means from the initial point to the final point, we must be going through a series of points, and each of those points are in some kind of a quasi-static state, or that means almost equilibrium state. So we can represent it as a series of points, which ultimately becomes a curve. And every point on the curve is a quasi-static point. That means at every point, the pressure, temperature, density, and all these things are defined consistently. And the gas follows the equation of the state. At any point in between, PVT, it follows this statement that PV is equal to NRT. Just like P final, V final is equal to NRT final. Like that, every state in between on the process is defined by the equation of state, because it is a static point. It's a quasi-static point. Okay. And Aman, I will just clear this point in a bit of time, but just as per your general knowledge, you should know that any quasi-static process is reversible, because you're going very slowly from one state to another state of equilibrium. So if you reverse the external change that you're making to go from one state to the next state, which is very close to the first one, it's like a differential change. It's a differential change at a time. So such differential changes can always be reversed in such a way that you can come back from final to initial point by the same path that you have gone from initial to final. So that is what we mean by a reversible process. So all quasi-static processes by definition are reversible. Whereas sudden changes may not be reversible because they are not quasi-static. So first of all, as long as the process is very slow or quasi-static, we can define the process by a curve on the PV space, where every point on that curve is an actual state of the gas, where it is defined by the relation PV equal to NRT. So every point on the curve is a unique state that the gas has gone through. And that unique state of the gas is defined by that unique value of PV equal to NRT at that point. That's the first thing. And second, that because it's a slow process and every point in between is an equilibrium point, it is called quasi-static, and by definition, all quasi-static processes are reversible. Yeah, in a sense, you can say that a perfectly quasi-static process will be a sort of an ideal kind of situation, an ideal experimental thing. In a real experimental change, it will be approximately quasi-static. It cannot be perfectly quasi-static, because obviously every point cannot be an equilibrium point. Okay, so now when we relate this PV graph and equation of state with our statement of first law, which is that Q is equal to delta U plus W. In this, the most important thing we can see is that the delta U is what we call a state function. I'm sure you've done all this in chemistry. It is called a state function, or it is the change in internal energy is path independent. That you can both understand conceptually as well as theoretically, as well as practically from this graph, that you can see that the internal energy is given by the formula NF by 2RT. So the change in internal energy is NF by 2R delta T, or final temperature minus initial temperature, or we can also write it as F by 2 into product of pressure and volume in the final state minus product of pressure and volume in the initial state. So this quantity, you can see, it does not depend on the path. If we have two different paths taking you from initial to final, the value of delta U will be the same for both the paths. Okay. It is path independent, means the value of delta U is same for all paths between the same two states. That is the initial state and the final state. Okay, so that is why always the quantity change in internal energy is easiest to calculate, because we don't need to know what is the exact path, what is the specification, what are the conditions under which the change is happening. We just need to know what is the initial state, what is the final state. So we know number of moles of the gas and the initial and final temperature, and we are also aware what type of gas it is. So we know the degrees of freedom. Then we can just directly from the formula calculate the value of delta U. We don't have to bother about what type of process it is undergoing. But obviously that is the only term in the first law statement, which is path independent. The other two terms become what we call path functions or path dependent terms. Okay, so this is the first formula out of the three terms, delta U, and the understanding that it is a state function and not a path function. But now if you notice the quantity work done, that is integration of PdV. So it is area under the PV curve, such that it is positive of the area for final volume being greater than initial volume, and it is negative of the area for compression. Okay. So obviously this becomes a path function, or what we call a path dependent calculation. Okay. So as a very simple example, suppose I have volume of, let's say, in liters and pressure in atmospheres. And in one case, I'm going from this point to this point via a horizontal straight line at a pressure of 1 atmosphere. From a volume of 1 liter to a volume of 3 liters. But in another case, I'm going by this kind of process. where as I'm going from 1 to 2 liters, the pressure is increasing from 1 to 2 atmospheres. And then as I'm going from 2 to 3 liters, the pressure again decreases from, okay, 2 to 1 atmospheres, okay. So you want to look at the work done by the gas in process 1 and 2. So calculate the work done by the gas in process 1 and process 2. From A to B. And secondly, if the gas is helium, find delta U from A to B. How much is the change in internal energy from A to B? Take 1 atmosphere to be approximately 10 raised power 5 pascals. So this should be a very easy question for you. Just try this out quickly. Yeah, Kevin, that's correct. What Yes, so the work done you can see is different in the two processes. In the second process, it's in fact 1.5 times the work done in the first process. Okay. So now we will also find out Q for each of the processes, not only work done and delta U, but we'll also find Q, the net heat supplied in each of the processes. So let's come to the first part. So you want to calculate work done, which is integration of PdV. So that is the area under the PV graph. Okay. So you can see that in the first case, it's basically what we will learn very soon as the isobaric expansion, because the pressure is remaining constant. So it is just that constant pressure multiplied by the change in volume, or it's the area under a horizontal straight line. So we just have to use that concept. So it is going from this state, whereas pressure is 1 atmosphere, from a volume of 1 liter to a volume of 3 liters. Okay, so this area is the work done. So for process one, work done is 1 atmosphere multiplied with 2 liters. So 2 liter atmosphere, which is 200 joules, because 1 liter atmosphere is equal to 10 raised power minus 3 meter cube into 10 raised power 5 pascals. So that is 100. Okay, so you should remember this also. 1 liter is 1000 milliliter, which is 1000 cc, or 1000 × 10⁻⁶ meter cube. So this is an important conversion. Whereas one atmosphere is actually 1.01 × 10⁵ pascals. So it's approximately equal to 10⁵ pascals. Actually, it's slightly larger than that. So anyway, that's this one. Okay, now in the second case, you can see the process is going like this. It is going to a pressure of 2 atmospheres. By the time the volume is becoming 2 liters. So this total area we have to calculate for the second one. So in process two, it's double of this area. So it is half into sum of parallel sides into the distance between them. This whole thing into two. So as you can see, it is 3 liter atmosphere, or plus 300 joules. So you can see that work done is a path function. Okay. Now, as far as delta U is concerned, N F by 2 R delta T. So here degrees of freedom is 3 because it's helium gas, and NRTB is, so 1 into 3 liter atmosphere, and NRTA is PAVA. So delta U is 3 by 2 into NRTB minus TA. So that is 3 by 2 into 3 minus 1 liter atmosphere. So the change in internal energy is equal to 3 liter atmosphere. With a positive sign, the temperature is increasing. So it is plus 300 joules. And it's a state function. It's independent of path. So I hope all of you got the same. Just remember it was helium gas. So degrees of freedom is 3. So use that. And the formula for delta U, NF by 2R delta T, where you can always use PV equal to NRT. If you don't know the number of moles or something is missing in the question like that, you can always replace NRT with the product of pressure and volume. So this is the standard way of solving any question with the application of first law of thermodynamics. Yes, Kevin, I'll scroll up. Okay, so Kevin, this is done, huh? Okay. So always remember, internal energy is a state function. So it will always come from the initial state and final state. We don't need to look at the graph. We don't need to do any area under the graph calculation by geometry or by integration, whatever is the requirement. Whereas this thing, work done, that is the path function. So that is the one precisely we need to look at the graph if the graph is given. or the formula of the process will be given, then we need to use integration, integration PDB. So this is the path function. This one is the state function. And now finally, we will use first law of thermodynamics to find Q in each case. So the third part for process one, Q will be equal to delta U plus W. So this is for the process one, so W1. Okay. So this will become 300 joules plus the work done in that case was only 200 joules. So 500 joules of heat is supplied to the gas to increase its volume by from 1 liter to 3 liters. Yes, very good. That's correct, Aman. Okay. While keeping the pressure constant. Whereas for process 2, we are going in a strange kind of path. We are first increasing the pressure while expanding it. And then again, we are reducing the pressure while continuing to expand the gas. So the amount of heat supplied is becoming different because we are doing a greater amount of work done. I mean, the gas is doing more work. So the work done by the gas is greater by a factor of 100 joules. So in order to accomplish that, we need to supply more heat. We need to supply a total of 600 joules of heat. So this 600 joules of heat we are supplying is resulting in the same change in internal energy of plus 300 joules. But the gas is ending up pushing the piston more. It's doing more work on the piston. It's doing work of 300 joules. Whereas in the earlier one, it was doing a work of only 500 joules. Okay, students, so we'll conclude today's lecture. Actually, because of some connectivity issue, I got disconnected. So we will take it from this point in the next lecture.